You know, you get an opportunity every once in a while to go to a location that you just know was a very special location. Maybe not always for the right reasons was it special, but you know, that doesn't really matter. The truth of the matter is, I'm outside of Columbus, Missouri, which used to be the county seat in Missouri. And I'm at a location that was a starting place to probably one of the biggest massacres in U.S. history. And that was the beginning of the raid on Lawrence, Kansas. And they were gonna be right over that hill. So if you look over there where the bend is and those trees, right along that creek over there, what you're gonna find is a place where over 200 men gathered in this very location to perform probably one of the most unbelievable massacres in U.S. history. And you know, this was retaliation. The unrest in this area was unbelievable. They had burnt towns. And then another catastrophe happened that probably sealed the fate of a bunch of people on the other side of the border in Kansas. Now, that was a prison, a federal prison that collapsed downtown. But who happened to be in that prison were the wives and the sisters of these bushwhackers that happened to be over in the corner over there preparing. Now what happened that fateful day was that jail collapsed and killing and maiming a lot of those girls that were, and ladies that were related to these bushwhackers. You know, some of the notable people in that situation was a guy named Bloody Bill Anderson. And they were prepared to go and seek vengeance for that operation. So that day of the 18th, they spent preparing and getting ready. And on the 19th, that band left here on its way to know Lawrence, Kansas. And now a lot of those guys didn't even know where they're going because Quantrill kept it a secret because this was Quantrill's crap in the Purdue farm area. And I'm telling you, they rode off to the southwest to Lawrence, Kansas. And they arrived on the morning of the 21st. And if you know or understand why they had an area called Bleeding Kansas, you will find out after the massacre that took place. Now, we're going to go there, so you're going to be able to see that. But the most important thing is, if you see where it all started, right here in this cornfield in 1863. It's just incredible to be down here because you realize that, man, it doesn't look that much different now. At that time, as you look over this, it was just prairie grass, very few trees along those banks as well. So you can imagine right over in that corner, you can imagine all these bushwhackers that were preparing to go meet a destiny that would change not only their lives, but the lives of the people that they met in Lawrence, Kansas. It's a fascinating story, so stick along as we go on. Now we're going to go to Lawrence, we're going to see the rest of what this story is, but this is the place that it started. It's fascinating. This is just fascinating to be here And right through this break in this cornfield, if you look across there, you would have seen 290 plus men preparing to make their fate. You know, we're at the south side of Lawrence on Harper Street. And if you were here on August 21st, 1863, and you were looking down this road right here, one thing you would have seen was the city of Lawrence. Because at that point, there were absolutely really no trees. And this would have been the high point of the town. And so Quantrill, 2 days after he left the Blackwater campsite, came to this location. Now his forces had swelled to almost 400 guerrillas. And so at 5 a.m., he sent two scouts down to Lawrence to see what was going on, if it was clear to go ahead and come into town. So those scouts came back and they told him that basically the town was clear. On the way in, Quantrill didn't know exactly how to get to this point. So on the way, what they did was they would grab guys from the area to try to figure out how to get to this point. Now, he would get these guys, and then after he was done with them, he would kill them. I mean, they came to Lawrence, Kansas with a vengeance. You know, Quantrill would have walked up to this door and he would have knocked on this door just like we're doing.
Hi, I'm Dennis Daly. This is the Robert Miller home. This house was built in, that part was built in 1858, this part in 1863, the same year that Quantrill marched right up in front of this house. They came in on what is basically the Oregon Trail. Which is never a trail, it's wherever it's dry. So we have some Oregon Trail back there, and he actually passed in front of the house.
Okay.
They came up the Oregon Trail, also known as the Franklin Road. Franklin is a little hamlet about 2 miles that direction, which was a pro-slavery hamlet. And at the time, 1863, Lawrence was 2 miles that direction. Downtown Lawrence, two or three blocks of downtown Lawrence.
Okay.
He rode in from up the Franklin Road, up the Oregon Trail. I've written a journal article about that. You can read it sometime if you like. They came up that trail, which passed directly in front of this house. They stopped here about 8:30 in the morning. One of the daughters, who was in her early 20s, Margaret, heard them, came to the door, visited with them. One of the men recognized her. Quantrill actually recognized her. She recognized him. And part of that part of the story is that 2 or 3 weeks before Quantrill came to Lawrence for the raid, one of his men came here on a scouting trip, and he spent the night here and had a meal here. And so they all knew some of them knew of the Millers, of their hospitality. They fed and watered their horses, and after a short period of time, they rode on.
Mm-hmm.
George, who was the youngest son, who was like 18 at the time, after the raid was over, he rode into town, but some of Quantrill's men met him, intercepted him, chased him back down the Oregon Trail. And he rode past this house over on the other side of our property. We've got 5 acres in here, and into a cornfield. And Quantrill's men never went into a cornfield because they didn't know it was going to be in there.
Right.
So there were many people saved in Lawrence because they went into cornfields and were basically held safe.
Well, that's Jim Lane, wasn't it? Jim Lane?
Jim Lane was on
the same thing. He ran into a cornfield, right, and they didn't chase him.
Jim Lane lived on the far west side of what Lawrence was then, which would be about like Mississippi, Alabama Street.
Okay.
And when he heard that they were coming in, he went into the cornfield, saved himself as a result of that.
So this house was saved because of the hospitality of the week. Is that what
there are several ways. There are several interpretations of that.
Right.
One is that this, if you've been to South Carolina, you've seen this house. Robert Miller came from South Carolina. He was a member of a group called the Associated Presbyterian Church. And when they settled in the 1700s in South Carolina, a whole group of them settled there. One of the principles of that particular church was that they could not hold slaves, which in the 1750s and 1780s and even early 1800s is not a problem. But by 1840, it was a serious problem. And Robert Miller was accosted in South Carolina, beat up by pro-slavery folks. And his son, one of his sons, came to Lawrence in 1854, Josiah Miller, who was a senator and a probate judge here in Lawrence, and wrote letters to his parents urging them to come to Lawrence. And I've written a journal article in the Journal of Kansas History on those letters, urging them to come. They hesitated, I think, partly because of their commitment to that religious group, partly because they had a huge farm holding in South Carolina. But ultimately, he sold his farm, and Mr. and Mrs. Robert Miller and Susanna Miller and several of their children moved to Illinois, spent a couple of years there, and then finally in 1858 came to Kansas City, by up the Mississippi to Kansas City, and then over here.
Mm-hmm.
That was in April of 1858, and by December of 1858 this house was built.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lovely old house.
So your history with this house, you knew what you were buying when you bought it. Were you connected with the house because of the history, or what's your history?
I was on the faculty at university.
Okay.
And we were looking for, we lived over on the other side of town in a very modern home, which is part of our taste. And one day in 1983, we drove by here, and there's a little bitty sign out in front of this set place that said for sale. And we whipped in and pulled up right here and went in to visit with Mrs. Eller. And about half an hour into that discussion, we discovered it wasn't only whether we would decide to go and live here, it's whether she decided we should live here.
Yeah.
Because they had some investment in the property and in the history. And I've been involved in that's not my field, but I was always interested in history. And when we came here, we renewed our interest in this history. And we've met members of the family. They've given us incredible photographs and documents associated with the Miller family.
Right.
It's amazing. So we have a lot of history that people come here like you, all the time. School children visit here five times a year. The most meaningful part for me is because this place was also a part of the Underground Railroad.
Right.
Is that black families will come and get out, and I will always go out and visit with them. And their experience with this place is completely different than my experience of this place, because their experience is heritage of slavery.
So black families would come here knowing their history.
Oh, yeah.
They're connected looking, with they, this as well.
They hear there's some stuff at the visitor center. They hear that this is one of the few places that's documented on the Underground Railroad. The slaves came up the same trail that Quantrill did.
Right.
The last time that happened, it was a family from Illinois, a father, a mother, and four children. He was in his 40s. He was on the faculty at the University of Illinois. And he was trying to explain to his children what this place was. And because the small smokehouse where slaves were kept when they came to this property is no longer here, mm-hmm. he wanted to know where was it? So it's right over there. And the whole family walked over there and stood there. And the dad tried to explain what visiting here meant to him. He got about halfway through that and just fell into tears, as did his wife. And I'm standing there trying to understand what that really meant. Mm-hmm. 419 years of slavery is what that meant. And it's being played out today.
Right.
So I've had some incredibly powerful moments with black families. Some of the Raider families have also visited here from Kansas City. Mm-hmm. And that's always a fascinating thing, because the last one was a great-great-granddaughter of either one great or two greats, I can't remember, of one of the Raiders. And I'm just telling the story. And I could see her wrestling with what ultimately turned out to be enormous personal guilt. Just huge personal guilt that she was associated with 200 men being slaughtered in this community in August of 1863. It's fascinating to watch unfold.
Right.
You never know which direction all that stuff's going to go.
Now, if we look through here, what we're going to find out is we're going to see a hand-dug well right here. It was a hand-dug well, for sure.
Just lined with stone. Can you imagine digging that out?
No.
She'd have to have like ropes and buckets and just kind of carry it up as you did it, I guess.
It would have been
about 28 feet deep.
That would not have been an easy job.
No, when you think about the wall, the water's way down there. All hand dug. There was a big try thing set up here. Like this. And they carried it out bucket by bucket.
Now, here is Miller, who was lived in that house down the way. One lived to 26, Carlisle. And there's Josiah, which was the son. And he lived about 50 years, died in Lawrence, Kansas. And then I'm sure the dad is over here as well. There's Mary and Irene. Agnes. And then here's more Millers over here. 1796 to 1882. So this is the Miller plot right through here. Miller family. Now, one of the gentlemen that they were looking for when Quantrill rode into Lawrence was this gentleman right here. And his name was James H. Lane. Now, that's junior, but senior's got to be here just as well. General James H. Lane, right there he is. So that was the guy that they, one of the guys that was on the list. Now he saved himself by running into the cornfield. And that's how a lot of people saved themselves when the rebels or the guerrillas from both sides were coming. They'd run into the cornfields. It's pretty incredible to see this. It really is. Kind of sombering. You know, we were talking about that, you know, the way they marked the memorial down there. This guy here did as much damage to his side, you know, to the other side as this guy did to his side. So it's kind of like funny how they did that. But you can tell we're in a pretty historical part of the. Quantrill left the Miller farm and headed towards Lawrence. He came to modern day 11th Street, which was at that time Quincy. Now at this time, the guerrillas decided the best way to assault Lawrence would be to split up into threes and go down the three main boulevards of Lawrence, which would be New Hampshire, Vermont, and Massachusetts. Now at this time also, the first casualty had occurred. Two members of the guerrilla party split off and went to a place known as Reverend Snyder's farm. He was out milking the cows, and that day they gunned him down in his front yard, and he died in his wife's arms. But that was the first casualty. But it was early, and there would be many, many more before this day was over. Now Quantrill, he would have led his men down the main drag, and that was Massachusetts. And what he encountered down here was a regiment of black soldiers that were basically brand new to the Corps. Now here's the funny thing about that. Some instances say that they were all killed, and some of the instances say that they all escaped. It's really funny how history, I mean, you would think that would be a pretty simple thing to figure out, but it definitely was not. So that's what's funny about history, is a lot of times you just don't know. I mean, there should be a record of that many recruits either escaping or being killed, but definitely there was not. So it's right on down here where he would have come down here. He would have taken his group down this main drag of Massachusetts, and he would get ready for one of the bloodiest encounters up to that period, considering this was mainly citizens. Now, why would they have come to Lawrence and risked all this journey all the way over here to the city of Lawrence? Well, you know, it was a hotbed for people that would go across and also do the same type of activities in Missouri. And this is where a lot of them based out of, you know, coming to Jim Lane, which we saw his grave marker in the cemetery. But there was also a lot more money here. This was a pretty influential town. So if you were going to attack somewhere, this would have been a great place to do it, to be able to get funds to also further your cause. But he headed right down this street as we speak right here before he encountered his first resistance at all. And it really wasn't much of a risk of resistance. It was new recruits that really didn't know what they were doing. And one side of this coin is that they all were killed. One side of the coin is they were all let go. So who knows at that point?
So right here at 1001, right here, would have been the location that the group that Quantrill first encountered that would have been camped out there. Now, I would have thought, in all honesty, that it would have been pretty difficult, that they wouldn't have attacked and it wouldn't have killed them regardless. I find that, I mean, Union soldiers in dress, I would find that hard to believe that Quantrill, they've already killed the first guy who was a member of the Union, so why wouldn't they kill these guys? But it's hard to say. But it was right there, if you can imagine, Quantrill coming down here with all that regiment of army. Now, he had 400 guys in the group, so you can figure that, 125 to 140 per group, and the main one coming down this part of town would have been an incredible sight to see.